There's been a bit of comment by readers and listeners to this program and my daily blogs about my sentiment towards militancy as it relates to our movement. And I stress, by the way, that it's only one of the things that comes up in this blog. I like to think I'm discussing spiritual matters, personal matters, prison matters, all the different aspects of my life. As each day goes by, I'm going to feel different sentiments at different times. But let's get down to this business of militancy. We have successes, yes, in the education, advocacy, and democratic participation aspects of the cannabis movement. The media is, in its editorials, is generally on our side, while the newsreels on TV still favor the police, prohibitionist politicians, and the war on drugs. Yes, we do get many letters to the editor printed. Yes, indeed. And we did get Jack Layton's NDP probably about 150,000 of their 2 million votes. But let's face it, facts are facts. Since 1970, when the Liberals in Canada promised decriminalization, about 1 million Canadians have been arrested or charged with cannabis offenses. 1 million of those have been convicted. Hundreds of thousands spent significant time in jail or prison. Some, like Rosie Robotham, spent 18 years in jail for cannabis. In 2003, a year when the Canadian courts declared marijuana legal for 9 months of that year, a record 90,000 arrests were made for years since decriminalization was promised to us by the very same Liberal government with Paul Martin in it back then, more of us are being rounded up than ever before. The new proposed Liberal bill offers an even wider net of police intervention. It offers greater sentencing for our gardeners. It offers a $250 million marijuana demonization propaganda budget. The government own talking points in their own papers show that they think this net widening effect is the primary purpose of the bill, to catch more people. So much for our activism of 33 years, more arrests than ever, more demonization of our culture, longer incarcerations. Look at me, I was sentenced to 3 months for passing one joint. Every one of you listening and reading this has passed one joint, and all of you could be next, and the numbers show that you will be next. A big decrim lie being introduced by our own Erwin Goebbels coddler is that somehow he's doing a humanitarian thing while in fact ratcheting up every aspect of the police state culture against us. So what has all our peaceful rallies and letters to the editor really got us when, by every single measurable determination, our cannabis culture is under greater attack than ever before? After 33 years of passive resistance with rallies, into the 21st century, the Canadian state is more willing than ever to destroy our culture in exactly the same way the Canadian state destroyed the First Nations culture. The four stages of genocide are demonization, segregation, incarceration, extermination. In exactly the same way the First Nations people were called savagers and heathens, the Jews were called Christ killers and moneylenders, demonization. And look at what has been said about us. And then segregation, the Jews forced into ghettos, the First Nations people forced into reserves. And what about us? Are not our hemp store temples violated frequently? Are we not denied transit to the United States? Are we not deemed unfit parents at the risk of losing our children and having them taken away? Are we not denied jobs as teachers, bankers, truckers, security officers, police officers, and many other professions if we are merely to acknowledge that we are part of the cannabis culture? Are we not urine tested to determine if we are members of this demonized culture? Do they not take thousands of children away from their Canadian Vietnamese parents who grow our sacrament? Did they not do that to the Jews in Europe, put them in ghettos and then separate the parents to create more unimaginable panic and anguish as they were sent to prisons or extermination camps? Or what of the First Nations people? Have their children been stolen from them now for four generations from 1920s to the 1980 period and were put in white re-education camps where the children were told that their cultural legacy was to be denied? Were the First Nations people not put on reservations segregated? Do not our schools and their puppets that teach our children offer the same thing? I dare anyone to say otherwise. We know this is true. After segregation comes incarceration. In the United States, over 125,000 people in local state jails and federal penitentiaries are there explicitly for being a human being of the cannabis culture, period. All your rallies and letter to the editor haven't stopped any of that. And that's today. Since Richard Nixon declared the war on drugs in 1973, 10 million Americans from 1970 to 2004 have been convicted of cannabis offenses, and over 1 million of them spent more than a year in jail. You don't think that's a gulag? You don't think that's right? They're up there with the most worst possible excesses of the modern genocidal state? Do you think your letters to the editor and your hemp fest have slowed the U.S. government's cannabis genocide? 1 million Americans spent over a year in jail for being a human being whose belief, their fundamental human right to worship their God with the Holy Sacrament, their lifestyle. Do you think that this would happen in anywhere other than the most murderous of barbaric tyrannies? The last 3 years have seen record arrests and incarcerations of the cannabis culture. The First Nations people believed the Canadian government, and they were demonized, segregated, slaughtered, and a large number of them remain incarcerated. I bet those Jewish professors in Germany tried to send letters to the editor also. It didn't save them from the ovens. Oh, Canadian Americans couldn't be complicit in genocide. You'd think, oh no, these are civilized people. Germany had Beethoven, Hegel, Goethe, and was considered the most civilized European nation at the onset of the 20th century. Who would have thought that the descendants of Beethoven would be complicit in the mass demonization, segregation, incarceration, and extermination of the harmless Jewish people? Who would have thought these civilized English and French Europeans could demonize the people of the land they invaded, slaughter them, steal their children, to effectively eradicate all traces of their culture? Why, the French and English are the two founding races of this country, Canada. Is this not true? The First Nation people trusted the so-called civilized and English and French with honoring land agreements and treaties, and they died in this belief or were placed, their children stolen in ghettos. There is no disputing the parallels between the First Nation people's experience, the passivity of the Jewish European culture in the face of imminent genocide, and the clear evidence and sheer numbers of victims in the cannabis culture. The identical methodology of the U.S. and Canadian governments is demonization, segregation, incarceration, and ultimately our extermination. It is precisely the same methodology the European Jews and the First Nation people were prey to. Our culture has witnessed this four-point genocidal program for 33 years, and despite millions of us suffering, without any evidence we are making any strides for our fundamental human rights. We are content to watch others go to jail in the tens of thousands, but our weaponry is the truth, some say, and I believe it is a mystical belief. It's a mystical belief if you think that is going to win the day. If you believe that, meet me at the jail or the mortuary, because that's where that philosophy will be end up discussing. That strategy is a dead-end strategy. We are all being rounded up every day in every country on earth by every government, whether Buddhist, European, Catholic, Communist, Islamic, ass-kissing U.S. puppet satellites like Canada or Mexico, or the great Satan itself, the United States. The war against us is using clear genocidal, murderous intent, and it has been going on for 33 years. Why? Because at its core, the cannabis culture is scared, frightened, cowardly, weak. We go to jail by the thousands as victims, but only handfuls go to jail as martyrs or warriors. We are weak. Our enemy knows that if our chief battle weapon is merely the truth of the matter and a letter to the editor, then our enemy is going to stomp us into oblivion. We need more warriors than letter writers. We need more martyrs if we were to have fewer victims. We need men to come forth and be men. Letters to the editor or begging letters to the justice minister, who is presiding over our imminent further demonization, arrest, incarceration, are futile. The justice minister, whose agent sent me to this gulag for 3 months for passing a joint. It could happen to you. It could happen to millions of us at any time. And you think a letter to the editor or your congressman or the justice minister is enough? We are surely all going to gulags and slaughterhouses then. Richard Cowan's phrase, freedom has nothing to fear from the truth, is all wrong. The question is, what does giant, barbarous, genocidal governments have to fear from the truth? And that answer is they have to fear nothing. When Richard Cowan says, what have you done for freedom lately, I would instead ask, what have you sacrificed for your freedom, for your culture, and for your people lately? And I say, you've done nothing at all. We're worse off than ever before, with more victims in Canada every 6 minutes, and in the USA, a new victim every 40 seconds. In the time it takes you to write your letter to the editor, or to your member of parliament, or to your congressman, 10 to 20 people, our people, were rounded up. Do you feel good about that, do you? You feel like you accomplished something, did you?